The largest subtropical wilderness in the United States, the Florida Everglades, is a finely balanced ecosystem that serves as an important habitat for various rare and endangered wildlife, including the American crocodile and Florida panther. But thanks to invasive species of plants and animals and sea level rise, this delicate wetland is under serious threat. Now, a new South Florida PBS series, Battleground Everglades, digs deep to examine the challenges and solutions to help restore this indispensable river of grass.
The Sunshine State has more non-native reptile and amphibian species than anywhere else in the world. More than 80% arrived here as part of the pet industry. But the deadliest invader has been the Burmese python. First seen in the Everglades in the 1980s, the population has exploded, decimating native mammals. One study reported that roadside sightings of raccoons, rabbits, foxes, and other local wildlife have dropped by more than 90% in the last few decades.
Wow.
Wildlife experts blame the huge pythons for destroying populations of small animals and wading birds, who for centuries have called the Everglades home. The snakes are not venomous, but they do bite. They kill their prey by constriction, wrapping their bodies around their victims and squeezing the life out of them.
And here to share more is author, Everglades expert, and host of Battleground Everglades, Charles Kropke. Wow, the video is just fascinating.
Yeah, Sandra, there are a lot of things that are happening out there in the glades, and they're all happening simultaneously. Mm-hmm. So it's very critical that we pay attention to what's happening because of the number of ways that we interact here in South Florida with the glades.
I was going to say, what do you hope this show will do for our community?
You know, I think that we need to understand that the Everglades, first of all, is our water supply. Mm-hmm. And that it's not a given that it will be there. It's a rain cycle. You know, the water on the surface rises up into clouds, which seed our rainfall cycle. If we were to break that surface water, then we break the rain cycle and we send this area, we plummet this area into desertification.
Is the Everglades, because you know the show, the name Battleground, are the Everglades doing better now than before? It's been, you know, we've been here for decades, the struggle to restore this beautiful part of our country. Is there success? Are we doing better?
Well, I'm a different stripe of environmentalist. Okay. I like to actually give credit where things have gone right.
Okay.
I think that the natural inclination for environmental people is to say, you know, the next issue. But yes, there have been improvements, everything from Melaleuca infestations mm-hmm. falling to bridges allowing waters to pass underneath the Tamiami Trail,
right.
sending water back to much needed Southern Everglades, the main body of Everglades National Park. There has been some improvements in water quality, but it's such a vast region and there are so many attack points
right.
that we need to be vigilant.
And now, you're talking about another attack site or point, sea level rise. Explain that. Why is it such a problem? What are you seeing?
Well, conceptually, it's hard to wrap your mind around the idea that water can hold back water. You
okay.
think, well, water just is water and it mixes. But the southern flow of water in our system is what's holding back the salt water that surrounds Florida, especially from Florida Bay, from coming up and destroying the peat mosses and the southern Everglades. So if we don't have enough flow of water from north to south, mm-hmm. then we're not going to hold back the influx of seawater. So that's just one example of how the seas are rising. We can see it on the beaches, we can see it in our communities, but it's affecting the Everglades in a very comprehensive way.
And that was my next question is, what is the danger of having too much seawater out there?
Well, you know, seawater is salt content. Mm-hmm. Most plants are not salt tolerant. Some are. So, you know, what might thrive in this environment are mangroves because they can handle salt water. But more mangroves, if they are reasserting the coastline of Florida, we're basically watching Florida disappear as the mangroves pull back to be the only plant life that can deal with salt water. And that's kind of what's happening. So in order to basically reconquer and reestablish the lines that Florida has held for some millennia, we have to have the fresh water there to push back the intrusion.
And how does that affect animals if there's too much salt water there?
Well, animals generally adapt if there's enough time. But when you add the multiple stresses, like the small mammals that are being stressed out from python kill-offs, and then you have the saltwater inundation and a change of habitat, you quicken the pace that they are, you know, that they have to make their changes, and sometimes they can't keep up that pace.
Well, we're excited to see the show. I assume it's fun for you too.
It's fun for me too. Yeah, I can't say that I don't like walking around in the swamp. I do.
Thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Sandra.
And you can catch an all-new episode of Battleground Everglades, the Battle Over Big Water, Wednesday, February 21st at 7:30 p.m. on WPBT, and on Thursday, February 22nd at 8 p.m. on WXEL.